Good evening, dear colleagues of the Executive MSCOM Alumni Association, dear potentials and future colleagues, dear friends. Welcome to the second sure fix of the Executive Alumni Association. It's my pleasure to welcome our partners, and tonight I would like to introduce our partners to you. We have here as our guest Urs Rellstab. Urs Rellstab is the CEO of Börsen Masterland Switzerland, and BM, as you probably know, is a global corporate communications agency and one of the partners from the very beginning of the MSCOM program and the Alumni Association. We will be coming back to BM later on when talking about a specific offer for our members. Together with yours tonight is Ute Dehn. She's a senior consultant and a member of the executive board, as well as a practice leader, corporate finance, and her colleague is Kurdin Mark. He's a senior consultant at BM. Then I would like to say hello to Nina Folles and Jill Parker. Jill is deputy managing director. Jill, where are you? Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. And you all know Jennifer Hayes. Jennifer Hayes is the Alumni Association Officer, and she also plays a role as an event manager for the MSCOM program. Last but not least, my colleagues from the board here tonight with us. Lisa Schilling, she's MSCOM 10, working for mobility, car sharing. We have Anita Bunk. She's not here, unfortunately. She's in the United States. She's MSCOM 9, working for Tyco Electronics in Bensheim, Germany. We have Eva Maria Giannini. She can't be here with us. She's MSCOM 1 and working for Arcos Capital in Lugano. Then we have Markus Helbling, who's MSCOM 7, working for Festival Rose Dorf in Lucerne. And we have Matthias in the last row, MSCOM 6, working for Coca-Cola Switzerland in Rüttisele, which is a I would also like to remind you of our regional representatives. We have regional representatives. They are also working together with the board and trying to establish the local community and events. So we have Stefania Isola, she's MSCOM 4 in Bellinzona. We have Stephanie Lauber, she's MSCOM 8, also in Geneva. And Dominic Marbet, he's also here tonight, MSCOM 8 from Basel. What is the Executive MSCOM Alumni Association? Just to take into mind some facts. It's rapidly growing. We have a network of 300 communication professionals from all kinds of countries all over the world. We just counted it today. We have representatives from 4 continents. We have a professional activity sectors, corporate agencies, public sectors, NGO, NPOs. The professional status, majority has a job in mid-management or executive level. The average age, 39 years. And the average experience, 13 years. And a good news, in January 2012, the next class, number 14 already, will start. And we also have some guests tonight, some potential, some future colleagues, hopefully, who are here. And if you have any questions, don't hesitate to get in touch with one of us. Regarding the events, as you probably know, we are working hardly on improving our benefits, our services, our events for you as members. And we are very happy to announce a few events we can offer to you. So in August 2011, we can invite you to a very exclusive event in Locarno. It's the film festival, and and our colleague Stefania Isola. She was able to organize this exclusive invitation for you together with Michele Iannuzzi. He's the director from Iannuzzi Smith London, which is the agency who was working with the festival to do this repositioning and rebranding of the festival. We will offer apéro, dinner, free entry to the films or to one of the films, and even a very interesting speech about this rebranding and repositioning process. So for more information, we invite you to get to the website and to see more information and also to register to this event. Thank you, Stefania, for organizing. Then in September 12th, we have our next Sure Fix taking place in Zurich, and it's going to be a symposium, The Future of Printed Products in the Age of Electronic News and Free Papers. We have invited Michael Voss from Ringier. He's actually the COO, right? COO. And Jan Bollmann. Jan Bollmann is an MSCOM alumni, and he is a publisher of a new magazine called Transhelvetica. It's a magazine about Swiss culture, Swiss traveling, Swiss etc. So very new, and it's going to be a very interesting discussion. So we would love to invite you for this. And probably October or maybe November, we are organizing a journey to Brussels. And this is what I mentioned at the beginning. We are going to organize it also together with Bursen Mastela, our partner. They're having their head office, European head office in Brussels. So we will be able to put together a very interesting program for you. Detailed information will follow as soon as possible, and also then the link for the registration. Some more dates for you, just as people are always very busy, to reserve the dates if you are interested. We have in November the Steamboat Ball, which is a social event. We have in June and July, there is the European Communication Summit taking place in Brussels. And as a member, you always get a reduced fee for the entry, for participation. In September, we have the MSCOM Excellence in Communication Lectures taking place in Zug at Siemens head office, and it's about influence and persuasion. In September 14 in Berlin, the Kommunikationskongress, where we also organize an apéro and a get-together for the people living in Germany, the MSCOM members. And even some more additional dates. You can also find the dates on our MSCOM website, and we also send out regularly safety dates to remind you of those events. And now I would like to come back to something I forgot to talk about in the beginning, which is very important. You already noticed we have a cameraman here, and we have a huge camera positioned in the middle of the room. And the reason for this is very easy. As I already mentioned, we are trying or working on it to improve the benefits and the services for our members. And as you also know, we are growing quite fastly, not only nationally, but also internationally. So as I mentioned, we have a lot of members, about 300 people, coming from nearly all over the world now. And one of the points is that all the people living outside Switzerland, they can't participate at those events because it's complicating to travel to Zurich. They don't have the public transport system as we have here in Switzerland. So what we were thinking about is to podcast the events so we can make it at their services on the website. So tonight is a trial, I have to say. We try, and we are trying to find out if this would serve the need of our colleagues living abroad. And I'm feeling like a bit on Saturday evening during the Concours d'Eurovision de Chanson, where you say, you know, hello to Germany and to Italy and to Oslo and to Mumbai, where we all have the people sitting, Russia, Africa, Australia, New Zealand, South America, and of course all our colleagues in Swiss Romand and in Ticino, because they also can't come because it's too far away. And we hope this will be a real benefit, and we're going to come back to you later to get your inputs if this is really a benefit or not. So that's also the reason why I'm nearly shouting, so we have everything on the micro. I would like to say thank you for attending tonight. We appreciate your interest and your commitment to the Alumni Association. It's very important for us. Now I'm quite happy. We have a speech, of course. And I would like to introduce Vera Stifler to you. Vera Stifler is an MSCOM 10. She was in my class. She graduated in 1999 from École Hôtelier de Lausanne. She has been working in the communications and marketing industry for over 10 years. She first worked in online marketing, managing international campaigns for 18 markets on client side Dell, as well as agency side Trade Doubler. In 2008, during our program, Vera moved on to the company Rhaetian Railway, or in Swiss German Rhaetische Bahn, in Graubünden, where she is since heading up marketing communications, events, and sponsoring. Over the last 2 years, she was on top project director of the festivities and jubilees of 100 years of the Bernina Line. Thank you very much for coming to Zurich and sharing your expertise. Vera, the stage is yours.
Thank you. Okay, good evening everybody. I'm full of cables, so please interrupt me if you need any correction for your camera. And please do interrupt me if I don't speak loud enough. As a woman, most of us, half of it in the room knows how it is, so just wave or there are some free seats here. Angela approached me to talk about a very easy topic, how to position a UNESCO World Heritage. as you will see along the presentation, it's mainly about the marketing and communications part and not so much about the whole candidateship, which is rather a dry topic. And I guess we're all here to talk about how to position and market a company and a product. Let's see how this works. Yes. So the presentation lasts about 35 to 40 minutes. The shortest part, I promise, is the company presentation. Then there's a quick part about actually how to become UNESCO World Heritage. What does it need in terms of requirements and why did we actually receive that label? And then the biggest part is ever since we received it 2 years ago, what are we actually doing to position it on a sustainable way? If you have questions, of course, do interrupt me. And otherwise, I guess, in about 40 minutes, we move over to the apéro. Okay, short, quick company presentation so that actually you know who this Rhaetische Bahn is. I love this slide because I always thank these guys up there. Without them, I wouldn't be here and we wouldn't be UNESCO. So it started about over 100 years ago when pioneers, and I always call them really crazy guys back then, started building a railway in the Alps. So in the middle of the mountains, they started digging holes, building tunnels, and imagine the winter conditions, the snowstorms. They didn't have machines and equipment like today. And in only 25 years, they built a whole network which is covering only the canton of Graubünden, the county of the Grisons. The whole engineering structure comprises 19% of tunnels and viaducts, so not only the railway as such. They have an average age of 85 years old. I'm coming back to that issue. So it's about 400 kilometers, and 30% of the railway is higher than 1,500 meters above sea level. So it's really in the Alps. And the highest gradient is 7%. It's quite steep. In total, we are about 1,300 employees. We are the second biggest employer in the Grisons. And we hire every year about 30 apprentices, like people, like young people from the area, to do their apprenticeship and to work with us. You see all kinds of people working in all kinds of different professions, so it's not only people like me sitting behind a desk and a PC and thinking about new stories. Now, in terms of client structures, compared to the SBB, I say this because we have someone here, where is Christoph in the room from SBB, we are to 80% a holiday or a tourist company. We transport about 8.5 million tourists every year, and about 20% of commuters, people who live in the area and commute from the village to the city or even further down to Zurich. We're also a sort of a motorway railway. We've built a Farina tunnel 10 years ago, which is also a car transporter which goes from Klosters to Engadin or vice versa, depending where you look at, which became quite a successful story, and we transport almost 500,000 of cars every year. Last but not least, we're also in the B2B business. We are transporting goods such as bottles from Pfalzer water, or food from Coop, wood from the forest, all sorts of goods. We do have quite an issue. As you can imagine, we are highly subsidized from the county and from the state. And as I showed earlier, we have bridges, viaducts with an average age of 85 years old, which means we do have ongoing renovations going on. The state and the county pay about 50 to 100 million every year only on renovation. So it's quite a big project going on. And it's not that today it's quite easy. Of course we have machines, of course we have more modern equipment. But when stones fall down on the railway, you have to remove them and you need strong men. Winter conditions, or strong women. Or women, yeah, but I haven't seen them there. Winter conditions are still the same. We have snowstorms. We have up to 2-3 meters of snow there, and it's still quite a heavy business for the workers there. We also try to really work on clear market positioning and on projects. We have on every train station now a very modern customer information system. We just built an e-business department. We are ISO certified, and we received 2 years ago the highest quality label in the tourism field of Switzerland tourism, which is the Q3 Gütesiegel. And we've just launched last year our latest modern rolling stock. You see the train here, which is called Allegra, which means basically hello and welcome. Officially, the candidateship took 3 years. I say unofficially it took over 100 years, because again, without these pioneers, obviously we wouldn't be UNESCO. We first of all needed the okay from the Grisons, from our biggest owner. Without them, we couldn't go into a candidateship. And we started in April, basically by defining the scope of the project, the scope of the definition of what should be UNESCO. We started doing a lot of lobbying. Obviously, as you can imagine, along this UNESCO World Heritage, you have many partners you need to talk to, you need money. It's not just the railway is affected, but all the partners are affected. Hello. We then basically wrote the management plan, sent it to the federal department, of culture. When we had their okay, it was sent to the UNESCO committee and took them 18 months to decide. But basically in July 2008, we got officially, we were part of the international list of UNESCO World Heritage, and then basically my job started. First of all, I only started then, which has nothing to do with UNESCO, but because I'm in marketing, obviously from that day on, everything we're doing, it has to be also in the mind of UNESCO. Just a quick explanation, which is quite important, of the naming of the label. It's not that the whole Rhaetian Railway is UNESCO, but it's the Rhaetian Railway in the landscape Albula and Bernina. Albula and Bernina are two valleys, and so it's one of, among other lines, of the Rhaetian Railway. Not sure if it's clear, but just part of the Rhaetian Railway is UNESCO. That's why it's called In the Landscape, Albula Bernina. So why actually are we part of it? Well, the UNESCO committee found our nature and these two valleys, Albula and Bernina, of unique nature. And the fact that these pioneers built an access to the south 100 years ago over the Alps was of economical and political interest and important back then and still today. Then we have two glaciers on that road. You have the Mortarach and the Palu Glacier, so which makes that the region there is quite unique. I come back to my pioneers, just a little story. When they built, actually, the railway 100 years ago, they could have built many more tunnels and galleries. It would have made their life much easier. But back then, there was no winter tourism. And they actually had the vision that maybe one day in the Alps would be winter tourism. So they decided to build as little tunnels and galleries as possible so that future potential winter tourists could see as much of the landscape as possible. So the railway is of unique character. Here you see it at the train stop, which is called Alp Grüm. There is no access by car, only by train. In the back is the Palu Glacier, which is disappearing, unfortunately, quite quickly. Then the railway is part of world-famous engineering structures. This is the Landwasser Viaduct, 90 meters high and 140 meters long. And the second one is sort of our masterpiece. It's the biggest circular viaduct in the Alps. It's 360 degrees. And there is also an artificial, actually, extension of the Albula Valley, because obviously you can build straight, but then the train, how can it go up? So we had sort of to stay within the maximum of 7% of gradient, which means that you have to extend the line, but on the same time, the pioneers tried to really harmonize the line within the landscape, which was also part of the decision of the UNESCO committee why we got part of it. There are a lot of cultural assets. Here, as an example, is the cathedral, the Basilica Madonna di Tirano in Italy. And when you cross the line, you cross three languages, Swiss German, Romanish, and the Swiss Italian. It's sort of a dialect of Italian and then Italian in Tirano. But also old traditions, like the boys on the right-hand side, it's called the Cialanda March, and they're trying to help disappear winter with their loud bells. So it's an old tradition. And all this is also part of that label. So to summarize, why the inclusion? Because A, it's a pioneering work of engineering, and B, it's of unique character. We then built our own vision 2 years ago, and we said we want to become the unique experience of the Alps. So quite a challenge. But it basically means whatever we do moving forward, we have this goal to be unique. So every project, any product we launch, it has to be unique, original, and authentic. Now, as you can imagine, once you become UNESCO, it's great, but you're not that free anymore, because all of a sudden there's a committee that looks at you and says, no, you can't do this, or yes, you should do it, but. So obviously it's great, but there are a lot of requirements. First of all, it's the area. Before we were our railway, we could basically do with our railway and our train stops whatever we wanted. All of a sudden we are UNESCO in the landscape, so we have all the communities along the line, we have the tourism destinations, we have a lot of partners that we have to inform when we launch new products, when we launch events. Then there is UNESCO operational guidelines for the implementation of the World Heritage Conventions. We are not talking about this. It sounds boring, it is, but it is very important for us. Obviously, we need to follow this. Then, actually, we own, on each train stop, you have a building. So we actually own 103 houses. And some of them are quite old, and probably we would like to destroy them and maybe build them in a ecological way or something, and no, it's part of UNESCO, so yes, we can renovate it, but it should look alike, and you know, it's quite complex. Then Italy, it ends or starts in Italy. All of a sudden we have customs, you have a language issue, then the province of Sondrio also wants to tell you what they would like to have when it comes to UNESCO World Heritage. So you have all of a sudden maybe a Swiss working style with an Italian one. And quite an important one is the protection and sustainable use. So again, when we renovate one of the viaducts, on the left-hand side it's the old one, on the right-hand side this is what the UNESCO committee wants to see. So basically for a tourist there's no big difference, it looks like you've just cleaned it. But in fact, there's quite a technological renovation going on. Inside, everything is new. And maybe we would have done it in a different way nowadays, but so we have these requirements. But I guess for the tourists, it's the best solution. Then obviously, also on the label, on the left and the middle side, you probably know this. This is the usual UNESCO label. We wanted to use this because everybody knows it, but this is for non-commercial use. And we obviously, although we are highly subsidized, we would like to sell. So we came up with our own label. Again, it's not just Rätische Bahn, but it's with our partners. In grey, the Botnisch Graubünden, which is obviously the sort of the roof tourism destination in Graubünden. And then in the middle, it's again sort of a snapshot of the landscape. In order to use this and for our partners, we had to come up with a corporate design and corporate identity manual, and we strictly follow these rules. So enough of theory now. Now how to position it? I mean, this is all okay, and you get this label, and honestly, the tourist came yesterday and it was not UNESCO, and he comes today and it is UNESCO. There's no difference. For him, maybe he sees a logo somewhere, but we really said, I mean, we want to be an example in Switzerland. We have, I think, 9 or 10 UNESCO World Heritage so far, and we really, really want to show what you can make, the use you can make out of it, and the worth of your brand that can increase. So you sort of need a plan. What do you want? And we said, well, you have the entry point Tuzis, the beginning of the Albula line, and the end point to Tirano, the beginning of the Bernina line, and in between we want tourists to experience something. We want them to hop off the train, to hike forward, backward, to have a rest stop, to learn something about the culture, maybe to hike with a tour guide, to hop on the train again, bring home a souvenir, of course. We want them to be able to book something, not only the train ride, but also the hotels. We want to be able that their baggage is moved from one hotel to the others. And we want to be able to show them, obviously, the latest trains we have. Now, in practice, what does it mean? It all starts with some drafts. And we always use this common theme, which is in red, so the Rote Faden. That's very important to us. Whatever we do, we follow this red. Basically, what we've done so far, we have some info points, and these red things are actually tracks, Schienen. And so when you hike, you see this, you see where you are in the UNESCO World Heritage, what is going on, maybe is there a church to visit or a museum. Also in the entry points, we have sort of the UNESCO World Heritage Door, we call this. So you see the bridge, below are the cars, up are the railway, you see these red doors. This is in Tirano. We were quite lucky to basically have a huge, huge signage board in the middle of the old town there. Then we came up with all sort of offers for groups, for schools. We have a UNESCO pass, so during 4 days you can travel for 99 francs and travel as many times as you want in the UNESCO World Heritage Area. And we've launched a hiking trail, which is the number 33 for those who are into hiking, with a partner. And we've launched a UNESCO tour guide, that is a Wanderbuch. And we've partnered with many, many partners, but one example is Switzerland Tourism brought out basically a topic called UNESCO Destination Switzerland. And we had this event coming up, and this was just at the right timing. Because we need something, we need a big bang, we need the partners to really hop on the train and to really build something and to celebrate. So, hop, there was this 100 years jubilee coming up, and it was just fitting perfect. Because it's part of the UNESCO, because this is the Bernina line. So we said, instead of just celebrating once this year, we want to celebrate all year long. Well, at the beginning. We said, every month's an event. So, let's do 4 during a year. So then we cover each season, and we cover sort of the main entry points. And we started in winter. And as I said, we want to be unique. So we built a snow dome. The biggest or tallest snow dome ever in Switzerland that you could enter and learn about how it was when the pioneers 100 years ago built this and about winter conditions on the Bernina. It all started with a median event because we said, well, it's quite dangerous to have many people up there in January because of avalanches. We cannot afford having thousands of people walking up there and then all of a sudden bad weather and avalanches. So we started only with media. Sorry. and we didn't go into that dangerous field, of course. What we did, we had our own engine on the middle left side with the topic 100 years of the Bernina line, and we had 22 snowmen. These snowmen were sitting in an open-door railway and just attached to the normal railways. And each snowman was representing one train stop along the route. And they were just traveling with us until they would melt away in March or April. Snow dome as well. We had to close it on Easter because it just became too dangerous to enter because of the weather. Then we said, well, it's red and we have this circular viaduct. We want a labyrinth. So we built a labyrinth. Labyrinth should obviously be something that's not so easy to go into the center. So it was a mix of an Irrgarten and a labyrinth. You could walk in it and there were questions. And depending if you were right and wrong, you would find a middle or get lost somewhere. And we had festivities with the minister, Doris Leuthard, but also a minister from Italy, and all the VIPs from Graubünden and the Grisons. Quite a party going on there. We also financially supported an artist who had this Klang sculpture, so a sound arc, he called it, and with wind you would hear some tones and music. Then we went down to Italy, and the party there was, as I said, and not to offend any Italians here, but it was maybe less structured and organized than what we had wanted. As you see in the middle on the left, all these people speaking with these things here. We had a program, we had 8 speakers, we ended up having 12. We learned about this in the morning, and the moderator, she just got crazy. And we didn't know how long they would talk and etc. But It was really nice, and it was the Southern spirit, which actually we also need. And then on the 5th of July, we said, okay, let's add a quick event. That was exactly the anniversary. And we wanted also to celebrate ourselves a little bit. So the board and the core team dressed up in dresses like 100 years ago. And we invited some media, mainly train medias. They're actually media specialized in trains. And basically the latest train was meeting the oldest one. So we did that was a small event, but quite some nice pictures coming up with it. We had about 13 exhibitions, not only obviously from the Eurasian Railway, but from our partners about how we used to live 100 years ago and how it is today. And obviously all our communication last year was with this topic, 100 years of the Bernina Line. Last but not least, I'm showing this chart because the ones who sit in front have received one of these giveaways, and the other ones can pick it up in the front or send me a mail. we have obviously created a lot of souvenirs, like we partnered with some partners with vineyards, some wine, pins for the really, really fans. They love it. We were quite lucky that Swiss Post and the Italian Post launched a stamp in our honor. We had caps. Swiss Mint was launching a coin. So we were actually quite happy that our partners were quite motivated to partner with us. And obviously this question always comes that how can you pay such an amount of money and how can you do this with subsidized money? Actually, we didn't. We had 59 sponsors. We said from the beginning on, whatever we do, we pay one third. So we went out to the partners and said, do you want this? Yes, okay, we pay one third. And so one third was paid by private sponsors and one third by public, like the communities or the tourist destinations. So the result were obviously many contacts. We only have the Swiss, like the Argus, we don't know internationally, but a lot of traffic on the website. We had about 40,000 visitors for exhibitions and the events. But what's obviously important for us, we had 33% more group bookings that year and 17% more tickets sold. We had 40 new books. So there was a lot of things going on last year. Sometimes we're quite lucky because one of these old engineering structures need to be renovated, and obviously this is not so nice because this is how it looks like. And the Landwasser Viaduct, I mean, during summer times, about a million visitors cross this viaduct, among maybe 20% of Asian people, and some of them only coming for this viaduct. So we had an issue. 9 months of this construction field, it just can't be it. So we said, well, let's turn this into an opportunity, again, a chance for us to position UNESCO and turn it into an eye catcher. This is what we did. This is a picture from Keystone. I just use it for internal presentation with the cows on it. On the back is the almost dressed land water viaduct. What we did, obviously a little joke with the no picture banner, because we obviously didn't want anyone to take a picture and to send it out before we had the official media event. So we just added this white banner. And walking on there with some media, we heard some voices saying, what? Is it forbidden to take a picture? But obviously then it was removed, and over the next 9 months, this is what it looked like. So I guess from the point of view of a tourist, that's probably more sexy than this here. And currently, as we speak, we have the issue with the circular viaduct, which also needs to be renovated, and this is what it looks right now. Okay, now, as I said, we've also built an e-commercial department, and when I came to the company, I came from digital media, so one of the reasons also was that we should do something on online media and digital media, because we're so much into print and brochures, and so we said, okay, let's do this, but it took about 2 years and maybe a new CEO to really get the money to do something, and we said, Okay, let's do really something on cross-media communication and said, okay, well, we do what a lot of companies do, we do an online contest. I mean, this is nothing new, but it might be new for a railway. And we start with our own employees. So we did an internal contest and did a casting. This group here won. We thought they're very, very authentic to communicate, to go out, and to motivate people to participate on this online contest. So we had these guys called Gramper, and we basically had them on all kinds of of advertising material. The slogan is, die ganze Schweiz kann erben. In English, it means whole Switzerland can inherit. And what we want to say is that, well, Dresden Railway is now UNESCO World Heritage. So please come and join us. We invite you to come and also inherit part of it. And that was the whole idea behind it. So we had these guys here going out and saying, well, come and join and send your club or association, send a picture, participate to the contest, and you win 3,000 Swiss francs and a weekend in the UNESCO World Heritage Area and a professional shooting with the pictures we are going to use on an offline campaign. Why associations? Vereine, because it's quite to do with traditions. And UNESCO is a tradition, Eurasian Railway is a tradition, so we said, basically every one of you probably is in a Verein or in a club. So we rent from Schober 30,000 addresses and said, okay, this is the way how we reach probably most people out there with quite little money. Obviously, we don't have millions of millions to spend. And we had online ads, we had a newsletter, and obviously we had a quick grammar film to explain. And the thing is, it's in Swiss German, but it's only a minute and a half, so for those who don't understand, just watch it.
Allegra, und grüezi miteinander. Wir sind Gramper von der Rätischen Bahn. Unsere Kollegen haben vor über 100 Jahren die fantastische Bahnstrecke gebaut. Und jetzt haben wir geerbt.
Wir alle.
Sie haben die wunderschöne Strecke mit der einmaligen und beeindruckenden
Viadukt! Tunnels!
Atemberaubendes Panorama. Von Tussis bis Tirano ist
UNESCO Welterbe.
Über das Erbe kann sich die ganze Schweiz freuen.
Auch Sie!
Bilden Sie einfach in Ihrem Verein, Club oder Freundeskreis eine Erbgemeinschaft aus 3 bis 10 Personen. Und machen Sie ein Foto von Ihrer Gruppe.
Am besten in Vereinskleidern oder Uniform.
So wie wir hier. Und dann machen Sie auf unserer Internetseite an der grossen Publikumsabstimmung mit.
Die 2 Erbgemeinschaften mit den meisten Stimmen gewinnen.
Je 3'000 Franken im Bar.
Für Ihre Vereinskasse und ein exklusives Wochenende im UNESCO Welterbe.
Und so setzlich nehmen Sie teil an unserer neuen Werbekampagne.
Ich bin ein professioneller Fotograf. Making-of-Film.
Mit allem, was dazugehört.
Melden Sie Ihre Erbegemeinschaft am besten sofort an.
Arrivai!
Und bis bald bei uns im UNESCO Welterbe.
So it doesn't look very professional, and that was actually on purpose, because we wanted all these associations to see, oh, it's actually just enough if on my iPhone I just take a picture and send it, and then I can win. That's why, obviously, it was made with professionals, but it was on purpose, a little bit lionhaft. Now the result was, so yesterday was the last day, we had almost 200 associations joining, with some of them up to 7,000 votes. It's public voting. You can vote for the next 2 weeks. If you want to go and have a look at it, you can just vote. We had some PR going on. Interestingly enough, the PR work was not a success because media just realized it's advertising. So that was quite interesting. We thought, oh, PR, ooh, it'll be huge. It was not. So just quite an interesting learning. Because the media normally, whatever we send out, they print it. Here they clearly said no. Or they said, yeah, okay, but, you know, we want some advertising. These are my two favorite ones. Actually, two. I mean, this is exactly what we wanted. We didn't want to have any train freaks. We didn't want to have hikers. Obviously, you have them as well. This is what we wanted. And two groups are chosen by public voting, so the ones who have as many votes as possible, and two are chosen by us. Now, you can imagine, the ones on the right-hand side, I would like to have them, but our board, I guess, they would shoot me. So what are we going to do with them? On mid of June, we are going to the UNESCO World Heritage, having a whole weekend in the Hotel Saratz in Pontresina. From there, with e-flyers, going to all different crazy locations, do the professional photo shooting, and to come up with an offline campaign. This stays in this room, please, with an idea like this. Obviously, we can't do this because it's not winter, but this is an idea. If, for example, a sauna club wins, this is a picture we would like to do. When we presented it to our board, one of the questions was, but where is the train? So we don't want to show the train. Or, for example, if one of the music association wins. So this is just our new way. So on one hand, it's cross-media. We go online, then we go offline. But on the other hand, we want Switzerland to participate. And we don't want to show the train. On mobile marketing, last summer, we have launched our first iPhone app. It's the UNESCO World Heritage app, where you can also basically download what you can hike, what you can see, with all the train stations, with all the things you can discover. So basically, just to summarize, if you want to position UNESCO World Heritage, it's a gift to receive it, but it takes a lot of time and work, and we are not nearly where we want to be. But you can be very unique still by being UNESCO and still by having these requirements, as shown with, for example, our cross-media campaign. You can partner with many partners along the route, but you have to come up with offers, obviously. It's not just the label. And what we did also to really create an experience to have these exhibitions along the route, the signages, which will stay, actually. Maybe not for 100 years, but for a while there. And that's it. Thank you.